Howdy, folks. Dr. Will Wong here, and welcome to tonight's edition of the Essentials of Life and Wellness. We've got a bunch of questions that are on backlog, so let us start answering them. Dear Dr. Wong, my chiropractor related that her 19-year-old son had a subdural hematoma requiring surgery shortly after birth. He had his first seizure at 15, and although they are rare, they're often enough that he's avoiding learning to drive. His neurologist has him on an anti-seizure drug, which his mother would like to get him off of. She says that she knows there's an answer, and then said she thinks it's scar tissue, which made me immediately think of you. Do you have any thoughts on using systemic enzymes for treating brain injuries and scar tissue? Any input would be greatly appreciated. And my answer is howdy. We know that the enzymes cross the blood-brain barrier from the use of retention enemas of systemic enzymes to unconscious brain trauma patients in German emergency rooms to reduce brain swelling because the use of corticosteroids, as was done in the past, greatly increased patient mortality. The use of systemic enzymes in cases of inoperable brain tumors. The use of systemic enzymes against spinal stenosis. Currently, the enzymes are used by alternative docs on the brain amyloid deposits, the fibrosis, and the inflammation had in Parkinson's and certain forms of dementia. Our research website, enzymescience.com, is currently down, or else I would refer you to the nearly 200 peer-reviewed journal-published studies there. My suggestion is that her son try this combination. Zymescence, one or two capsules taken three times daily. Magscorbate, one capsule, two times daily. From us at drwongsessentials.com. And also take any sublingual B12 supplement, one eyedropper full, two times daily. Folic acid or methylfolicin, 15 to 20 milligrams, two times daily. B-complex, one capsule, two times daily, from your health food store or online. Lastly, MCT oil from Viva Labs, one tablespoon in coffee or over food, two times daily, available online. The enzymes will work against the inflammation and the scar tissue. The bees and the MCT oil will help create neurotransmitters, which are B-complex vitamins bonded onto saturated fats. This particular saturated fat, the medium-chain triglyceride, makes up 70% of brain tissue, and that is what we think with, we neurotransmit with, and along with the B vitamins and amino acids, form memories from. So we're not only addressing any remaining brain inflammation, which we know can last for life after a brain insult. We're also addressing the scar tissue that formed from the chronic inflammation and adding the nutrients the brain needs to maintain itself and create new neurotransmitters. Hope these ideas help. Be well and God bless. Dr. Wong. And the next question reads, hello, Dr. Wong. Yesterday I was talking to some guys at the gym about the fact that testosterone levels in men have dropped throughout time and also penis size on average. Now that provoked a lot of skeptical reactions to my surprise. I realized soon after that I had to back up what I said and I had no such material. I tried quick research, but it seems like finding a needle in a haystack kind of work. I'm not a doc, so I'm not used to searching such material. So I want to ask you if you can please guide me towards some rock-hard studies and or statistics about this. Ideally, the statistics would be both U.S. and EU. Some of these guys are actually doctors and, to my surprise, had no knowledge about the importance of testosterone levels in men's health. No surprise here. And my answer is howdy. Think I speak to some of those reference materials in my men's book, but most of those materials have never been put on the internet. The old sexology magazine of the 1960s and 70s had a ton of research data on penis size, sperm count, and when those averages are compared to the averages today per country, the difference is obvious. While I remember the data and the magazines, I don't physically have the research articles on hand. These folks still have some issues of Sexology magazine, and I referred him to ablebooks.com. Here's today's ranking by country, and I sent him to World Population Review, as they have data on the average penis size per country, both the largest and the smallest. And then on sperm count, I sent him to a time.com article on infertility, men, and sperm count. The averages of the 1960s and 70s were that penis sizes were 7 to 8 inches in size. When girth was added, that made an even greater difference, as hardly anyone today, except for the pornographic stars, are as thick around as men used to be back then. And a physician friend of mine, Dr. Herman von Game, who has since passed on, he died at 97, he was the youngest flight surgeon in the Luftwaffe in World War II, told me that penis size had shrunk further still, because in his grandfather's generation, the average penis sizes in Central Europe and Italy were larger than those had post-World War II. Now, in the U.S., the numbers can further be delineated by race or subrace, such as Mediterranean white, Scandinavian and Northern European, black, even mestizo. My guess is that during the process of feminizing humanity, which started with the soy formula in 1973, the hormone-disruptive pesticides such as atrazine, which can turn male frogs into female frogs, all the xeno and phytoestrogens from plastics to flax, the push for estrogen-rich vegetarian and vegan diets, the powers that be don't want the men of the world to figure out they're being progressively made infertile and castrated. The mainstream media has just now noticed a lack of manhood in society. Gee whiz! Better late than never, I suppose, but I've been preaching this about this for over 20 years, and I sent him to an article in investmentwatchdog.com titled, "There is a Crisis of Masculinity in the United States." And I ended, "Be well and God bless, Dr. Wong." Now, what's penis size got to do with fertility? The closer a man can ejaculate to a woman's cervix while she's in the fertile period of her cycle, the more likely she is going to conceive. The further away the penis is down the vaginal shaft, the longer the sperm have to swim and maybe find the entrance to the cervix, maybe not. When you couple that with the fact that sperm count in men has decreased to about 20,000 sperm per milliliter of ejaculate. It used to be 100,000 sperm per milliliter of ejaculate just 50 years ago. In the 1960s, having 20,000 sperm per milliliter of ejaculate was considered marginally fertile. Today, it's considered the norm. We can see how things will get complicated in terms of getting a gal pregnant. And as per this fellow's last comment, that the doctors that he works out with in his gym have no clue about the role of testosterone in men's health, that comes because of the lack of endocrine education in med school. The doctors get maybe a half an hour worth of androgens, which are the two male hormones, testosterone and dihydrotestosterone, and most of that half an hour is taken up by bad-mouthing anabolic steroids and never getting into the functions of testosterone versus dihydrotestosterone, so most MDs think they're both the same. The same way that most MDs don't know the difference between progesterone, progestin, and progestin, the three forms of progestin hormones in a human body. Even most OBGYNs don't have a clue as to what progesterone does in the human body. They study a lot about the thyroid, a little bit about estrogen, but they never quite get into the fact that two of the forms of estrogen, the ones made by changing testosterone into estrone or estradiol, that those two hormones are kind of bad to the point where 97% of cancers are caused by those two hormones. And that the only good form of estrogen is estriol, which is extremely benign and very beneficial. They never get into any of that. They don't get into hormonal therapy. This is one of the reasons why, for the last 20-some-odd years, I've been teaching newbies in anti-aging hormonal therapy about the use of aromatase inhibitors, about the use of this, about the use of that. And the docs sit there. These are licensed physicians. Sit there in wide-eyed wonder at what they didn't get in med school. So what the hell is being taught in endocrinology? Mostly thyroid, as I said before. Hardly anything else. Because medicine has such a poor understanding of the endocrine system, they don't want to let anyone know that they don't know jack shit about the endocrine system. And med school curriculums have been designed that way so that the doctors take no notice of all of the estrogens in the environment. Things like the pesticides, things like that atrazine that I spoke of, the pesticide that turns frogs from male frogs into female frogs. What will that do to humans? Things like the soy and the flax in foods, things like the new soy burgers and the veggie burgers that are coming out that have like 480,000 times more estrogen than a birth control pill does. Things like the first things that wound children's brains and throw off their hormonal function, soy formula, which with each bottle of soy formula, depending on the brand, having between 3 to 5 to 8 birth control pills worth of estrogen in the soy. Birth control pill is typically between 3 to 5 micrograms of estrogen. And there's more than that, much more than that, in each bottle of soy formula. So you feed a boy soy formula 4 to 6 times a day. You feed him a bottle 4 to 6 times a day. How many birth control pills worth of estrogen is he getting? You feed a baby girl 4 to 6 birth control pills per bottle per day. How much estrogen is she getting? Soy kills testicular tissue. Soy causes an overabundance of estrogen, which decreases testosterone output. A boy between 6 months and 2 or 3 years old has the same testosterone level as an 18-year-old. It forms part of his brains. It's supposed to form part of the anterior pituitary, the little thing the size of a grain of sand that's formed from testosterone, salt, and calcium, that tells a boy that he's a boy. Why are so many boys out there thinking that they're girls? Because they don't have that little tiny part of the anterior pituitary. Dr. Lendon Smith in the 60s and 70s was a very well-known pediatrician who had his own television show. He was on the level. He had a son who was homosexual who died of HIV. He wanted to find out what it was about homosexual men that made them homosexual. So he autopsied over 3,000, I think it was actually 3,500 bodies of homosexual men who had died of HIV, and he found one common denominator in all of them. Actually, 3 common denominators. They were low on serum calcium, low on serum sodium. I don't think he took a testosterone level on them. But every single one of these homosexual men were lacking that little tiny grain of sand part of their anterior pituitary that tells a guy that he's a guy. The hormone disruptors affect the brain first. The entire reason the brain grows is because of testosterone and progesterone. These days, when they do stem cell therapy to try to regenerate brains, the first thing that they do is they bathe the patient in progesterone, because progesterone is what helps brains to grow. So you're throwing in estrogen. Estrogen is known to cause inflammation, fibrosis, and shrinkage of the internal organs. Now, we know that that happens in old age when everyone becomes estrogen dominant. It's part of our natural obsolescence, part of the plan for getting us off the planet. You throw in the estrogen, you inflame the internal organs, you shrink them in size, you diminish their function, you have the body create tons and tons and tons of little enzyme called PDE5, which kills nitric oxide, which closes off the blood vessels, meaning that all of the internal organs get less blood supply, putting them in a kind of a mild state of ischemia, maybe just shy of ischemia, but certainly starving them of nutrients and especially of oxygen. And you begin to see that what we're taught in med school, that disease states go from irritation to inflammation to induration to hardening. You begin to see that process exactly taking place in old age. What if they discovered a way to make that process happen via estrogen? Because estrogen, again, is what sparks that process. What if they found a way to make that process happen in younger folks via all this estrogen? So girls who are exposed to the soy formula usually don't grow as tall as the girls who are breastfed, and the reason for that is because they go into menstruation so much earlier. And at menstruation, a woman's extremities stop growing. So the later a gal goes into menstruation, the taller she's going to be, given that she's got good nutrition, that is. Because, for example, if the parents had been raised to be carnivores, but the parents are now raising kids to be vegetarian, the vegetarian kids will never get as big as their carnivore parents got. And I've spoken to physicians who are so embarrassed and sad and that they were big and hulking and strong, and their kids turned out to be puny and little and weak because they became vegans or vegetarians somewhere along the line, and they forced that diet onto their children. And they didn't figure it out or learn any better until their kids were full grown, and then it was too damn late. But getting back to the subject of estrogen, it's the estrogen in food, the estrogen in the environment, the estrogen we're all swimming in that is causing a good many of the diseases of man. Remember that I said 97% of cancers are sparked into existence and driven in their growth by estradiol and estrone. And what are the birth control pills that are given out? Estradiol. What are the vaginal implants that are given out for birth control? Estradiol. What's the major hormone used in HRT for women? Estradiol. Do they ever use estriol, the safe estrogen? No. Why should they? The whole idea is to make you sick so that you bring more money into the medical industry. Just like the whole idea of releasing a virus is to sell you the vaccine to give you the cure. And the next question reads, hello, I just purchased the essentials and the vitamin E. Do you have a protocol to follow? I'm not sure how and what and how many to take. I'm in good health, slightly overweight, and a menopausal woman. I've been listening to you for years on Patrick Timpone's show and on your YouTube channel. Thank you. And my answer is, howdy. Thank you for listening. If by the essentials you mean the zymescence, zinc citrate, mag scorbate, and Karuna Pure, here's the essential basic program. Zymescence, one or two capsules taken three times daily. Zinc citrate, one capsule taken daily. Mag scorbate, one capsule two times daily. Vitamin E, one capsule two times daily. The Karuna Pure Progesterone Cream, follow insert directions for age and menstrual status. Now, the one thing I forgot to mention in my response to this email that is in my essentials article is a stabilized oxygen. Stabilized oxygen supplements are made from chlorine dioxide. And if you want to learn about the effects of chlorine dioxide against bacteria and viruses and the safety of chlorine dioxide, look up Andreas Klocker, Dr. Andreas Klocker's website on the internet. But of the available stabilized oxygen products, the one we use is the one from the Oxygenesis company, which is called ASO. Usually, we take 20 drops in any beverage, twice a day just for maintenance. If we're actually fighting off a bug, 30 drops in any beverage, 4 to 6 times a day. And the next question reads, dear Dr. Wong, I'm sure you have been asked this before, but are there any nutrients that are contraindicated when taking systemic enzymes like serapeptase? I have read in particular that one shouldn't eat grape seed extract with serapeptase. I was using zymescence, but suspended it because I use a quality VX1 grape seed extract and wanted your opinion before I start up again. I value your opinion rather than assertions made by people who don't understand enzymes like you do. And my answer is howdy. In 20 years of dealing with enzymes, studying them from fermentation to manufacturing to therapeutic applications on two continents, I've yet to see anything about a substance that might inhibit the action of enzymes, save an acid, and even that's been worked around by culturing the enzyme strains during fermentation to be acid resistant. When dealing with a zymescence, even the old strictures against taking an enzyme away from food fall away, because an empty stomach is not as necessary with a zymescence as it was with the older, weaker blends of systemic enzymes in the past. The older, weaker blends feared that a substantial portion of their enzymatic activity would be lost to digestion if taken near food, and not enough of the enzymes would be available for absorption and body-wide action. With zymescence, that's not so much the case, as it only takes 1/12 to 1/16 of the enzymatic activity of one zymescence capsule to digest to Thanksgiving or Christmas feast. In other words, one zymescence capsule has the enzymatic action to digest 12 to 16 Thanksgiving suppers. So taking zymescence with or near food will not result in a loss sufficient enough to impair the systemic body-wide action of the enzymes. If possible, take the zymescence 30 minutes before a meal or 60 minutes after. But if it isn't possible, take it anyway, and don't worry. Also know that you can take any supplement, oil, herb, medication with the enzymes and not have an adverse effect either. In fact, it's a nearly 100-year-old trick in pharmacology that anything taken or blended with a proteolytic enzyme has greatly improved absorption and utilization. That's why in Europe and Asia, medications are blended with serapeptase or pancreatin in them. Hope this clears things up. Be well and God bless. Dr. Wong. And he had a follow-up question. Thanks, Dr. Wong. I suppose that some people feel that if you're taking a nutrient that thins the blood, say like vitamin E, grapeseed, etc., that the systemic enzymes will cause the blood to thin even more, and that could become dangerous. I understand the caution about taking things before surgery, but normally speaking, even though you say that nutrients and enzymes don't adversely affect each other, do they potentiate each other to the point where blood thinning would be an issue? I do not take blood-thinning medications, only things like vitamin E and grapeseed extract and other various foods and nutrients allegedly thin the blood. And so I want to be comfortable. If I take a few zymescence, it shouldn't be a problem. And my answer is, howdy. The only enzyme that can thin the blood dangerously at low doses is nattokinase. Of the other proteolytic enzymes, most have a feedback mechanism to know when to stop lysing, when to stop eating blood proteins, and will only thin blood at very high levels of dosing. If our enzymescience.com website were still up, I'd send you there to find the research, but that server crashed and we've yet to rebuild the site elsewhere. Wobenzyme, for example, did a human study where they fed test subjects the equivalent of 3,750 tablets of Wobenzyme a day for several months. No one hemorrhaged. No one bled out after cutting themselves shaving, as one famous doc I know thought he was going to do after using just a little bit, 3 capsules of nattokinase daily. And they were all healthier after the study than prior. Considering that over 70% of the strokes and heart attacks are ischemic, caused by blood clots, you're in far more trouble having thickened blood than thinner. Of the zymescence, no one takes high doses because there's no need to. The usual dose of 3 per day, 6 if really inflamed or with serious fibrosis issues, is all most people need. The only folks who need to take high doses, i.e., above 9 capsules, are the competitive strongmen, athletes, and some patients abroad doing special therapies, which I'm not supposed to name. Those folks and docs are advised to take 1 milligram of vitamin K1, not K2, but K1, if their zymesis dose is above 8 capsules a day. That's it. Be well and God bless. Dr. Wong. Now, just to give you a for instance, those 9 capsules a day that those foreign clinics are using for that unmentionable condition replaced the 300 tablets of the systemic enzyme they first used to use, or the 100 tablets of the systemic enzyme that was specific to the condition that they're treating. They replaced those 300 or 100 with 9 of ours, because ours are just that strong. And on that note, I will wish you all God's blessings, be well, and I'll chat with you again next time. Bye-bye.
Thank you for joining Dr. Wong this evening for the Essentials of Life and Wellness. If you have any questions about this show, or if you want to ask Dr. Wong any health-related questions, you may email those questions to him directly at askdrwong@drwongsessentials.com. The products Dr. Wong recommends can be found online at drwongsessentials.com, or you can speak with a customer service representative at 866-268-3216. Dr. Wong also has an extensive natural health website written in Dr. Wong's unique and easy-to-understand style that discusses remedies for some of today's most debilitating and chronic conditions. Those are at drwong.us. Dr. Wong's lecture and podcast from 2007 through 2016 can be heard at drwongradio.com. His podcasts since 2016 and his lecture, Fighting the Things Most Likely to Kill Us, can be found on YouTube by searching for Dr. William Wong's Essentials of Life and Wellness. Until next time, we hope you have a safe and healthy week. Be well and God bless.